Visiting the church this morning, and it's great to have you here. Any visitors or guests to acknowledge this morning? Okay, well, our silent auction fundraiser wraps up today after the service, and here with the announcement is Mr. Bob Hoy.
Boy, you'll be glad not to see me next week. This is it, guys. This is it. Good news is, looks like almost everything has a bid on. Some are even over the top. Great job. We will start to shut down the tables at about 11:45. We'll give you a little bit of time, and then we're going to shut them down about every 10 minutes. We're going to start with the West Wall. Does everybody know where West is? I think so. Anyway. We have table hosts on each one of those, and they will be marking the winners and turning them into the cashiers. If you are successful on more than one table, you can wait until then. If you forgot your checkbook, your credit's good. But while we're doing all this, enjoy the hors d'oeuvres. I mean, man, it's not lunch, but it's close. So enjoy that at that time of fellowship together as you're going around making your final bids. Anyway. We thank you very much for your participation. This project was being used financially for the completion of the patio. So we're hoping that we'll pretty much cover the expenses. So if you have any questions about anything that's going around, Mike Bolas or myself will be walking around, and appreciate all the help of the committee that put this all together, particularly all the food, and for those of you who donated, we appreciate that too. So thank you very much.
ASP will be having their Painting for a Purpose fundraiser on Saturday, December 3rd at 10 a.m. to raise money for their 2017 mission trip. Please sign up in the Narthex if you'd like to participate. Again, that's Saturday, December 3rd. Recreation's coming back to HUM. They're going to perform their Christmas program on Tuesday, November 29th at 7 p.m. Tickets are $5, can be purchased at the church office all week, or after the service today, Caitlin Beckett will be selling those in the enclosed porch off the Narthex. Again, that show will be on Tuesday, November 29th at 7 p.m. Janelle, Darren, do you have an announcement this morning?
Good morning. For those children and their parents who signed up to pass out children's bulletins, we have put a list together, and it is hanging on the bulletin board in the Narthex, rotation for those kids that want to hand out bulletins. So if you could please check on that. And I won't be in here during prayers, joys and concerns, so I'm going to ask if you can keep Michelle in your prayers. She fell and has a broken rib. So if you can just keep her in your prayers.
Okay, and lastly, I don't know how many of you remember Miss Maud and Miss Myrtle. Does that sound familiar? Okay, for those of you who have never met them, I'd like to introduce them. They're visiting us this morning from their Southern Baptist Church in Mount Pleasant. They were here about a month ago to see Smoke on the Mountain, and they decided to extend their stay because they heard about the upcoming garage sale Christmas party on December 1st. So they are ladies of the church who believe in following the rules. And their rules say there will be lots of fun to be had at the party as long as there's no unacceptable behavior such as dancing. Did you hear me, Darren family? So ladies.
So much that we decided to stay for your Christmas party, and it's going to be on December 1st, which is only less than 2 weeks away. It's at 5:30 in the fellowship hall. You don't have to sign up or nothing. You just come with your covered dish, which can be a dessert, of a casserole or a salad, and everybody's invited. Everybody's invited. Kids, teenagers, adults, we're just going to have a real good time. And there's going to be entertainment, too. The Ryder family's going to be here. They're going to sing for us. And the Darren family. The Darren family.
Not the Darren family.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Oh, my Lord. They danced. They danced in church in the play.
I forgot all about that. Oh, dear. I'm so shocked I forgot my next line. Okay, it'll be okay, I guess. Santa's helper's here, and he's going to show us. Everybody gets a prize. Everybody gets a gift. And so he's here to show us what some of them gifts might be. Come in, Santa's helper. Come on, I already goofed up once. Where is he? Santa's helper. This ain't part of it. I don't know what happened to him. Oh, here he is. Oh, thank God. Hi, Santa's helper. You gonna show us some gifts?
What do you have?
What do you have?
Whoa!
Those look like dancing shoes! No. Can't. No, put them back in the bag. Put them back. What else you got? Oh, now that's okay. That's a toy. Oh, my gosh.
Stop!
Oh, they're dancing.
No dancing. You know, this is how it starts. You have dancing in church. Then you have bingo. And before you know it, there's a garage sale in the church.
We're out of here. We can't put up with this.
Okay, any other announcements this morning? Okay, seeing none. Flowers on the altar this morning are given by Debbie Messino in loving memory of Tom Messino. Flowers are also given by Chuck and Sue Baker in celebration of Avery Gebhardt's 7th birthday. She's homesick, but she's counting down their 4 days until her birthday. And I know we have 3 people in our congregation celebrating birthdays this week on Thanksgiving. Avery, Elizabeth Darren, and Mrs. Nancy Hoy. Right? So happy birthday to you guys. Turkey and cake. Great combination. And I heard a rumor that Jack and Lily Luster's birthday is today. So happy birthday to you guys. Okay, let's take time to greet one another.
Friends, I'm going to invite you to remain standing as you turn to your places, please. And please stay remain standing if you are able.
We're beginning our time of worship today. It's Thanksgiving week, so our theme is about giving thanks. Our opening song this morning is Thank You, Lord. Let's join together, please. We do gather in this place to thank you. Thank you for the wondrous God that you are, for your wondrous love for us, for how you provide for us in ways that go beyond our understanding. Your love for us is so great, and so we gather here to worship you, to surrender our hearts and lives to you for just a little while this morning, to not worry about the things outside of this place and the problems outside, but just to come here and center ourselves and say thanks to you and worship you for the God that you are. So fill this place and each of us with your spirit this morning as we worship you. In a spirit of thanks and praise. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
One of the things that I am really, really thankful for in this church is our music. And Firmly Grounded got us going this morning, but we're really, really thankful for you, the congregation, who sings along with us. And we'd like to do a really big Thanksgiving anthem this morning with brass, choir, and we're going to need your voices. The words will appear on the screen. It's the hymn you know, Come Be Thankful, People Come. So let's all be thankful and raise our voices and raise the roof of HUM today.
Thank you.
thanks for in our churches all the children that God has entrusted to us. And at Thanksgiving time, we usually present as a sign of gratitude for our kids, third grade Bibles to our third graders. A number of them are going to be here this morning, and Miss Tappy is going to assist me this morning. I'm going to ask Miss Tappy to come up and help me. And if you are in third grade this year, we have a Bible for you. We invite you to come up if you are in third grade. We'll bring everybody else up in a minute, okay? We'll bring up the third graders first. And I'm going to get you in a line and face the congregation like this. We'll get you in a straight line, okay? You're in third grade. You can make a straight line and face the congregation, okay? Go over here, Lucy. Get in a straight line. Thank you. Okay. It'll be out of order because we're not going to be lined up in the order of the Bibles. That's okay, though. I'm going to read the life verse. It's Tappy. Okay, Keaton's life verse is Romans 5:1. It says, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Congratulations, Keaton. Bella, yours is Psalm 10:17, and it says on your bookmark, Lord, you know the hopes of the helpless. Surely you will hear their cries and comfort them. Part of your verse is 2 Corinthians 8:24. It says, therefore, show these men the proof of your love and the reason for our pride in you so that the churches can see it. You're welcome. These verses are matched up with their birthdays. Their birthday is a chapter and verse matches them for their birthday. Aiden, your verse is from Philippians 2:1. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and one of mind. Congratulations. Lucy, your verse is from Zechariah 12:5. Then the clans of Judah will say in their hearts, the people of Jerusalem are strong because the Lord Almighty is their God. Here, Lucy, here's your bookmark, Lucy. Stay up here a minute. Can you stay up here a minute so we can get your picture with everybody? Elliot, yours is Isaiah 6:3. And they were calling to one another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. Little, yours is Ezekiel 11:20. Then they will follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. They will be my people and I will be their God. Philip. Philippians 4:13. It's even got Philip in it. How about that? I can do all this through him who gives me strength. Elizabeth, yours is Daniel 7:18. But the holy people of the Most High will receive the kingdom and will possess it forever, yes, forever and ever. Gavin? For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Romans 10:10. Jack, yours is from Jeremiah 11:20. But you, Lord Almighty, who judge righteously and test the heart and mind, let me see your vengeance on them, for to you I have committed my cause. Claire, yours is from Colossians 2:2. My goal is that they may be encouraged in heart and united in love, so they may have the full riches of complete understanding, in order that they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ. Congratulations. Mallory. Here's this 1 Corinthians 5:7, for we live by faith, not by sight. Did everybody get theirs? Okay, so I'm going to have you turn and face the congregation. Can you get back in line again? Let's move down a little bit again, okay? Can you move down a little bit this way? Move the line down a little bit. And if anyone's got their cell phone, that way they can get a picture of everybody with their third grade Bibles, okay? All right, you know what? Let's do this. Ladies, can I have you all come down on this first step? And gentlemen, can I have you come over here behind the ladies? Can I do that? Can you get over here and look behind the ladies? And that'll make the pictures a little easier. We'll get a few pictures, everybody, with the third grade Bible, okay? So a few people could get pictures for us, that would be great. A few people could not be here this morning. There's still a small stack of third graders there. Okay, there's another half dozen or so. So listen, we are so proud. We want to say we are so proud of all of you, okay? We're very proud. We know that you are old enough now to be able to read and understand your Bibles, okay? So we give it to you now so you can have this. And that, based on your birthday, is a verse, okay, that you can have on that bookmark to mark your place. We hope that you'll read your Bibles and learn about God's love for you, okay? We do that here in church, but we want to have that at home and everything, too, to remember how much God loves us. And this is a book that teaches us always about how much God loves us, okay? All right, let's have a round of applause for our third graders. Okay, don't go anywhere. I'm going to invite the other kids up and join us. We're going to sing a song first and then do the children's message. So stay up here, third graders, and all the other kids can come and join us, please. First, I'm going to have you stand up and turn and face the congregation again, okay? We're going to stand up and turn and face the congregation again, okay? Little ones towards the front, if we can, okay? Can you come to the front? Let's put the little ones in the front, if we can, okay? Thank you. So we can try to see people, okay? Spread out so we can see people. We're going to sing the Fruit of the Spirit song, okay? Okay, I'm going to stand in the back here since we're in this kind of group now, okay? Well, good morning. You have to be more enthusiastic than the adults. You ready? Good morning.
Good morning!
Welcome to the house of the Lord today, okay? Everybody, whether you're in third grade or not, right? We are so thankful everybody can be up here today, all right? You already were in third grade. You will be in third grade. You have a Bible. You will get one. We're so thankful for all of you because it's Thanksgiving time, right? How many days of school you got this week?
Two.
Right? Well, everybody has two? Everybody does? Okay, 2 days, and then it's going to be Thanksgiving time. And you know what's going to happen on Thanksgiving. You're going to make cards with red hearts on them and say, "Will you be my Valentine?" and pass them out to people and everything.
No.
Is this the one where you put up lights on your house and a green tree and that kind of stuff? And no? Is this the one where you wake up in the morning and you say April Fools and you try to play a joke on people and stuff? All right, I can't remember. What happens on this day? What happens on Thanksgiving? You eat turkey. That's what you do, right? What else? You give thanks for what you have. That is an excellent answer, okay? What do you do to give thanks? What do you do to give thanks? Does anybody do anything to give thanks? How do you give thanks? You eat turkey? Is that how you give thanks? How do you give thanks? Yes, I know your birthday is on Thanksgiving. What else? How do you give thanks? Do you do anything to give thanks? Do you do anything before you eat? Besides have a food fight or something like that? Do you do anything before you eat? What do you do before you eat? You pray, okay? And who do you pray to? And what do you think you say in that prayer before you eat on Thanksgiving? That we want to say thanks for our food, and not just for our food, but for everything God gives to us. Okay, Mr. L, can you help with the bookmark? It's okay, we'll fix it. Okay, so that's one of the things that we do, okay? We can pray. Is there another way that we can give thanks besides praying? You do anything at your house at all to give thanks at Thanksgiving time? Okay, when someone does something nice for you, what do you usually say? You say thank you, right? Why do you think we do that? Why do your mom and dad, why do they teach you to say thank you? Tell me why. It is being polite, okay? But it teaches us something. It teaches that when someone gives us something, has done something nice for us, that we want to be thankful. We want to say thanks in return, okay? For toys and presents and things like that. Things that people can give you, okay? Or love that people give you. They give us things and we want to be thankful, okay? So the way we do that is to say thanks to people in some way. So, I'm telling you, the people you need to be thankful for when it's Thanksgiving Day, how many of here are planning on cooking the turkey themselves? How many kids up here are planning on cooking the turkey? Yeah. How many people here are planning on peeling the potatoes to make the mashed potatoes? How many people here are planning on baking the pumpkin pie or whatever it is you're gonna have at your house, sitting up here this morning? Some of you are helping with that, okay? But you know the people who are doing those things to take care of us are moms and dads and grandparents and all the people who are gonna be there who love us. So I'm telling us as kids, one thing we can do to say thanks at Thanksgiving is to make a card, just like you'd make a Christmas card or a birthday card for somebody, that says thanks to those people who are loving you and taking care of you, okay? I would like to hear that everybody up here has made a Thanksgiving card to give to the people who take care of them and love them, okay? I'm challenging you to do something at Thanksgiving. You're off school. You got time to make a card, right? That says thanks for all those people who are loving you and taking care of you, okay? And we want to try to do something nice for them. See if you can help somehow, okay? A food fight is not helping, right? Not clearing your plate off the table, that's not helping, right? Do something helpful to try to say thanks for how they take care of us and love us, okay? All right, because God wants us to say thanks to the people who love us and take care of us, okay? That's why they teach us to say thank you. There's a song from VeggieTales. Has anyone ever seen VeggieTales before? There's a song, I love VeggieTales. Everybody should watch VeggieTales. There's a song in VeggieTales that says, "A thankful heart is a happy heart. A thankful heart is a happy heart." I really believe, I'm talking about this with the adults today, I really believe that our hearts are happy when they're thankful. If we always think about things that we don't have, it's hard to be thankful. But if we remember all the good things we have and the people who love us, then we can be thankful and we can have a happy heart. All right, let's say a little prayer together, everybody, okay? Okay, let's pray together. Dear God, we just give you thanks. We give you thanks for your love. And we pray in Thanksgiving and always remember to give thanks for your great love for us. Help us to remember to do something, whether making a card or doing something nice, to say thanks to the people who love us. May we always remember to thank you because of your great love for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks, everybody. Unless you're on the dance team, you can go back to Children's Church unless you're on the dance, liturgical dance team.
We offer our prayers to God with our joys and concerns. If you have a joy or concern you wish to share, please raise your hand, and usher will bring you a microphone. Please keep Peggy Cascaden in your prayers as she's recovering from a fractured hip and wrist at Gillette Nursing Home. Sally Allen asks for prayers for her daughter Mara as she's recovering from a recent surgery.
I just want to say thank you to everyone for all the cards, the food, and just lifting me up in your prayers. It meant so much, and I'm healing. It's a slow process, but I'm getting there. And so I thank you for everything that you have done for me. I also have a prayer request. Our 17-year-old grandson was diagnosed with Crohn's this week. And he had plans to go into the service next year after graduation, and he's not going to be able to do that. So now he has to come up with a plan B. And so this is very devastating for Nicholas. So please keep Nicholas in your prayers. Thank you.
Fred Black asked for prayers for Pat Walker, who's battling cancer. Jackie Jones asked for prayers for Lucy McLeister, who's been hospitalized, also battling cancer.
Okay, good morning. I just wanted to say about the Christmas dinner. I don't know, some of you have heard my story before. We were kind of newer to the church a few years ago when we came to the Christmas party dinner, or garage sale Christmas party, that's what I'm trying to get out. But you do a gift exchange, everybody gets a gift, including the children and the adults. Mary does a wonderful, wonderful job preparing for that. And then you kind of change gifts as they're still wrapped. And a couple of years ago, I got 3 lumps of coal, which I was not very happy with after dinner. But you know, a week or two later, we're out making snowmen in the yard, and I'm like, what can I use to make eyeballs and a nose? And I got the 3 lumps of coal out. So it was very, very wonderful and very, very great. And last year I was lucky enough to get a snowman's hat to go with my lumps of coal. And I don't think we ever got a chance to use that last year, but I look forward to it this year. So if anybody is thinking about coming, just come. It's a great time. Everybody will have a wonderful time, but I figured I would share that this morning. So, and thank you, Mary, for my hat from last year. I lost you. There you go. Thank you.
Thank you, Debbie.
Please, can everyone just keep my family in their prayers? We're just battling with some things in the family, so just please keep us all in our prayers.
Carol Klentz asked for prayers for her friend Shannon Benvenuti, who's recovering from 4 different arm surgeries. Nanette Isom asked for prayers for her son Tori, who was in the hospital last week battling pneumonia. And please keep Kay Dunlap and family in your prayers. Kay was interim pastor here a few years ago. Keep their family in your prayers as they're dealing with a family matter.
I have a friend whose son is 48. And he's battling alcoholism to the point where they don't think he's going to make it. So please pray for him. And also, you don't have to bring a gift. Santa Claus brings them all. So just come.
We wanted to give a huge thank you to the youth group for babysitting last night. We had about 30 people that went out last night, so thank you so much. It was so nice to just be able to go out and relax for a few hours. So anytime you want to do that.
Thanks, Tara. Any other joys or concerns to share this morning?
Yeah, I have a joy this morning. Last week I was in Copley, Ohio, house sitting. And I went to Copley United Methodist Church. A little late, had a cold, but the cohesive unit we have in this church is something very special, and I'm glad to be a part of it. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Any other joys or concerns to share this morning? Okay, seeing none, we'll sing together prayer hymn number 92, For the Beauty of the Earth.
Thank you. Lord God, what a wonderful week it is. Yes, we offer you our grateful praise. But not only this week, but every day of our lives. Lord, should we never forget to get up in the morning and just say, thank you, Lord, for breath. Thank you, Lord, that I can walk. Thank you, Lord, that I'm able to love you and praise you and give thanks. If we took a whole year, we could praise God day after day and hour after hour and minute after minute. And so, Lord, we praise you this morning and we give thanks for all that you mean to us and all that you are, all that you give to us and all that you do. And even, Lord, when you say no, we say thank you because you know what's best for us. Lord, so many needs always in the church. People who are going to have surgery, people struggling with illness and disease, people, Lord, who just need that special touch from you, people with heart problems, that names we didn't even mention. Lord, surgeries every week, always somebody that we can bow our heads to and say, Lord, hear our prayer. We give thanks, Lord, that you promised not only to hear, but you promised to answer in your way, in your time. And we're thankful, Lord, for answered prayer. That's why we stand here every week, Lord, and we come in your presence and we take a moment to joyfully pour our hearts out to you for family and friends and say, thank you, Lord. I know you're hearing. I know, Lord, you'll be doing. I pray for our country, Lord. I ask an anointing upon it and its leadership, especially in the transfer leadership. I ask you to be in the midst of all this as there are so many concerns. Lord, you're still on the throne. I thank God that you're still on the throne. You still rule and reign, and I praise you for that. And I celebrate it. I ask you to be with Matt this morning as he preaches and touch them. Thank you for all the children, Lord. We gave him a Bible. Thank you for your word, Lord. You gave it to us so that we would know and learn and be all we could be for you. Thank you for our children. Thank you for the anointing that falls upon them. Thank you, Lord, for our church, who does so much for them in teaching and sharing and doing, and bless our teachers. Bless those in the choir. Bless all our church folks. There's a song came out a few years ago, thank you, Lord, for giving. Giving to me. Thank you, church, for giving to me, to the dear family, to all of those who are part of this wonderful church. Thank you for blessings and anointings that come. Thank you, Lord, that you're there standing by, holding hands, saying prayers, bringing food, doing all these things for God so people can see God in us and through us and might live in us. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Lord, for our church and our people. Thank you, Lord, for the prayer that you taught us when you said, pray like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory of God.
Before the ushers come forward this morning, I'm going to make a brief announcement about the Estimate of Giving card that's found in your bulletin today. It'll be there next weekend in the newsletter coming out as well. And I would just preface this by saying, I know you hear a lot about people, the reason they don't go to church is because the church is always asking for money. Well, we do have fundraisers during the year, like the silent auction and things like that, but I only ever do this once a year. So anybody ever comes to this church and says, they talk about money all the time there, that's not the case here. So here's my annual pitch, my explanation of this, okay? The finance team is asking everyone to please complete an estimate of giving card and turn it in by the end of this calendar year. We are meeting our budget in full this year, even though we had to buy 2,000 third grade Bibles this year, okay? Next year's budget is going up a little over $11,000. You see that in your bulletin. That's about 3.5%. That's basically because the staff is getting a 3% raise next year. Even Clay, we're even giving Clay a raise next year. And we're planning to do more in missions next year. So we do need those of you who are able to give a little bit more, if you're able to check that box and give a little bit more as you're able to do so. Now let me just say that these estimate of giving cards are kept confidential. I don't see them. Mike Bolas, who is the finance secretary, he records those things for you for tax purposes. I do not see these. The finance team do not see these. They're kept confidential. Here is why they're important, if you've never filled one out before. We apply for grants. We apply for grants, which is free money. We receive some grants now, and we will apply for some next year. Whether or not we decide to expand the building, which we're considering, we're going to be probably expanding the staff to do some new ministries, like a before, after school program here, some sports ministries and things like that. One of the big deciding factors in what churches get those grants is what percentage of your congregation has completed an estimate of giving card. Not on the district level, but on the conference level, that's a big factor in those grants. They don't want to give grants to churches where only about half the people have turned in an estimate of giving card because they think the people there aren't really committed to the ministry of the church. But when they see a church where 90% of the people have turned in an estimate of giving card, the people on those committees think, hey, they're serious about it there. They're really all supporting the church and what's going on there. And I know that because I've been on those teams myself, and I've got friends on those teams right now. So even if you're only giving $20 a week, if you're only giving $1 a week, if you take the time to fill this out, it takes 2 minutes, it helps us tremendously in securing grants from the conference level for us to be able to get grants here to do our church. So I can't stress that enough. That's why it's important. It's confidential. Nobody sees it. It's between you and God and the financial secretary for tax purposes, and that allows us to get grants. That's it. That's my big money speech for the year, okay? Once a year, you hear me say, please take a minute and fill this out. It helps us. We're meeting our church budget in full. The question is always, how much can we do to help other people in missions outside this church based on what you give? If you've never filled one out before, it helps us if you do. And if you've done it in the past, it helps us if you do. If everyone fills it out, it helps us get grants. Let me just say that your generous support is what makes the ministry of this church possible. The reason we have so many kids up here is because of your generous support, the time you give and the money that you give to be able to do God's work here in this place. This church has grown tremendously and done incredible things in the past few years, and that's because of your generous support. So we ask you to continue to give as you are able. Hopefully we'll need 2,000 more third grade Bibles next year, right? And that's because of all that you do and give. So thank you for that. Our Lord Jesus said that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. We worship God at this time for the offering of our hearts and treasures.
Dear God, we place our trust in your truth and your grace. We pray that both our monetary gifts and our gifts of service will help others to see your kingdom, to draw closer to you, and to find ultimate peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm going to ask if you would please to pray with me once more. Please take a moment to pray with me and for me. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. There's a verse you hear me say every week when we're about to receive the morning offering. You've probably heard me say it so many times by now, you probably don't even think about the words anymore, what they mean. But every week when we're about to receive the offering, I quote one of my favorite verses, which is Matthew 6:21. Where Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You hear me say that every week. Jesus means in that verse that if you want to know what matters most to you in your life, where your heart is, you want to know what you really love in this life, what you treasure in this world, then, like the old saying goes, follow the money. Follow the money. The things we spend our money on and give our money to shows what we value most in this world. And for most of us, that quite honestly means our family. And many of us in this room are married or live with someone we love or have raised kids or are raising kids now. And our money is spent on our mortgage or rent, on utilities and food. In my case, I spend it mostly on milk. But our money is spent on providing for the people we love most, as it should be. Our money is spent on providing for the people we love most because, like the old saying goes, follow the money. Who do we love most? Our wives, our husbands, our children, our parents, our close friends. The people we love most in this world, that's where our money goes. Most of it anyways. The primal side of me, the dad in me who wants to be a provider for my kids, who wants my kids to have everything they need and honestly, sometimes things that they want and don't really need. My heart breaks for people who lose their jobs. As a pastor, I can't tell you how many times I've seen this over the years. I wonder sometimes if that were happened to me, I would be so desperate to provide for my kids what kind of jobs I might take until I could find something else, you know, scrubbing floors, flipping burgers, whatever I could do, because you want so desperately to provide for the people that you love. And my heart breaks for people who struggle to meet their day-to-day life expenses to provide for their kids. And of course, in the world that most of us live in here in America, it's almost unimaginable for us to consider places in Africa or around the world where truly people, they lack clean water, they lack enough food to eat. We know that those places exist, but they're so far removed from the world that we live in, we don't really think about it very much. Thursday, I will be at my mother's in North Carolina sitting down with my family to a feast much of this world could never conceive of. The amount of food that my family will consume in one day is beyond the dreams of much of the world. But they love their kids too. They love their families too, and they want to provide for them. I tell you this morning that I worry about money sometimes. Gabrielle's about to go off to college. She's a senior in high school. I have nothing saved. I confessed that to you freely. I only finished paying off Janelle and my own student loans a few years ago. So I worry about providing for my family, for the people that I love. I worry about providing for Janelle in retirement because she'll probably outlive me by like 20 years. The people in her family live forever on both sides, you know? Women live longer than men usually anyway, so I worried about Janelle being 100 years old and being provided for. It's the primal dad in me, you know what I mean, or husband in me, that need to provide for the people that I love. And so I worry sometimes. And when I worry, I always have to remind myself of this, to be thankful. To be thankful. I remember that many places in this world don't have clean water. I remember that most of the people in this world would trade places with me in a heartbeat. Most of the people in this world would trade places with me in a heartbeat, and so I'm thankful. Do you want to know what the antidote to worrying is? Do you want to know what the cure for worrying is, what the opposite of worrying is? It's thankfulness. It's thankfulness and faith. Thankfulness is the ability to look away from my worries to my blessings. That's what thankfulness is. The ability to look away from my worries and at my blessings. So to not worry about how I'm going to send kids to college, but thankfulness for the kids that God has blessed me with. To know that God has always been with me in the past. To know that God will be with me in the future, because that's faith. I'm going to look together at my favorite passage about worrying. It's found from Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 through 34. Where Jesus says, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon, in all his splendor, was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat?' or 'What shall we drink?' or 'What shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these other things, they'll be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." It's really easy to read that passage, right, and think that the words are true, but it's so hard to live them out, because we love the people we love so deeply. We love them so deeply that we worry about providing for them. And the only way we can even try to live those words out, the only way we can try not to worry so much sometimes, is to be thankful for all that we have, for all that God has already given us, to look around at all of creation, like that scripture says, the birds, the flowers. God has it all taken care of. He holds the whole world in his hands. God's got it all under control. And if we would look not at our worries, but at our blessings, we would see God has it under control. And for those of you who are so blessed that you never really have to worry about money right now at this time in your lives, you have a lot to be thankful for. You have a lot to be thankful for. And God calls us to give back out of gratitude for all that we've been given. That's the purpose of Thanksgiving, to gather with the people that you love, those people that you treasure, that you value most, that you spent your time on, you spent your finances on, you spent all that you have from your heart on, and gather with them and thank God that you can be with them and celebrate that time with them, that God has given those people to you, those people you try to provide for so much, to give thanks that they're in your life, that you can celebrate your blessings together. Finally, I want to call your attention to just a few verses that are just before the ones we just read about worrying together in the Bible. These come just before those verses, starting with verse 19 from Matthew 6. "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up treasures for yourselves in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal." And verse 21 says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." That's the final verse of that passage, verse 21. "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Things that you treasure, that's where your money goes. The things you treasure, that's where your money goes. One of the things we should treasure most is God. If you want to know that you're not just saying you treasure God, but are living it out, take a minute to follow the money in your life, to think about where your money goes, how much of it goes to God and to the work that God does on this earth to build his kingdom here. And I'm not talking about tithing this morning. I would just say, for example, if your monthly giving isn't much higher than your monthly cable bill, then maybe you don't value God much more than television. Just think about that. Maybe you really treasure TV more. And here's the thing. There's hardly anything on TV worth watching anymore, guys. Right? It's hard to find something on because there's so much crap on TV anymore. Or the amount of time that you spend, the amount of money you spend playing golf or buying clothes or shopping, whatever it might be in your life. Of course, treasure your family. Of course, provide for their needs. God treasures them too. God has entrusted you to take care of those people in your life. Of course, we need to do that. But treasure God too. Lay up treasures for yourself in heaven, not just here on earth. Because those people that don't have the ability to provide for their families, that we help in mission all the time, that's where the money that we give goes. To change lives and help them. It's like Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The more we treasure God, the more we treasure those in need, the more we support what God is doing here on this earth to help them. So I encourage you to complete an estimate of giving card, not just because of the grants that we can receive, because knowing that when you do so, you help someone you might never meet provide for the people that they love the most too. That's why we give, because God loves those people, and God wants to bless them, and he does it through your generosity, through your giving, through your thankfulness. Amen. I invite you to please stand if you're able. We're going to join together in our closing song this morning. It's Good, Good Father.
You are perfect. perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
Oh, it's love so
for the people that I love. That's true of everyone around this world. And my heart breaks for people, not just in Africa, but anywhere where people need help to provide for the people that they love. And I believe that God is a good, good father whose heart breaks for those parents as well, trying to help their kids. And you know how those people receive help? They receive it through our generosity, our thankfulness back to God for what God has done for us. God loves those kids just like God loves our kids. And we change the world when we are generous out of what God has given us to give back to God so that God can bless all his kids all over this world with his love and goodness because he's a good, good father. So my big pitch for the whole year, once a year, gang, okay? Don't just fill out an estimate of giving card because it helps us get grants. Fill it out because you are thankful for what God has given you so that God can take that and change the world. We pay our bills here every year. That's not the question. The question is, how much are we going to give to missions to change the world and meet the needs of all God's children everywhere we can? That's why we give, because we're thankful for that. As you leave this place this morning with thankful hearts, and knowing you have a good, good Father. May the blessings of God the Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, and the peace and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you forevermore. Amen.
You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who I am. It's who I am.